We need to all realize that the worst the times are, the better the help. So actually, we're in the worst of times, and we're in the best of times, depending on whether or not we are open to the opportunity to be helped. The help is pouring in the form of clarification. It's a tremendous time. The opportunities are simply tremendous, because we literally have been able to advance the narrative to seeing now that we've been wandering in the wilderness of belief, and that the remedy is to return to certainty. And it's becoming very, very clear now. And with that, all of the obstacles are seeming to, the mirage is vanishing. It was only a mirage of belief. So the future is tremendously bright for those who are seeing through belief, the great facade of belief, the great bully of belief. Fantastic times. And we need to do that now, because if we don't, then the situation will be very bad, because our wandering in the forest of belief we will find ourselves getting deeper and deeper and deeper into that forest, and it gets scarier and scarier and scarier, and we continually keep turning to belief to guide us, and it only leads us deeper and deeper and deeper, and it gets worse and worse and worse. Now consider this. If you just for one time were experienced the welcome of certainty, the unconditional welcome of certainty, and you realize that you have been accepted and welcomed by certainty, into the arms of certainty, then how is it that we could possibly arrive at the conclusion that we wouldn't be welcome again? Because consider what it is that welcomed us. It was certainty that welcomed us. 100% perfect certainty. So how could that possibly change? If it was certain to give us an unconditional welcome, it must be certain now. Can perfect certainty change? What could change it? What could really change perfect certainty? If perfect certainty says, you are welcome, I welcome you, it knows for 100% certain that you're welcome. So how could time and space and situations change that in any way? If you can, I glimpsed this today, I saw it. I caught belief in a bold-faced lie, saying belief says that certainty, you can't be certain that it's going to welcome you again. That's belief. You cannot be certain. That's its belief's premise. You can never be certain. You cannot be certain. But if certainty itself welcomes you, you should be 100% certain it'll welcome you again. You can be certain, because certainty was certain. So here we catch belief in a complete lie, expose it completely, saying you can't be certain that certainty will welcome you again. Well, certainty was certain that you're welcome. You see, and therefore it must be certain that you're always welcome. How could certainty say, well, I'm certain you're welcome now, but you're not going to be welcome in the future? Because certainty's certain about whether fundamentally you are welcome or not. And if you were not welcome in the future, it would know that, and it wouldn't give you an unconditional welcome. Would not. So if you've had an unconditional welcome by certainty, you can be sure, you can be certain that that welcome is still there for you, just exactly the same for you. You're still 100% welcome. And this needs to be seen. You have to see it for yourself. But I saw it for myself today and I said, wow, belief is just an absolute liar. It's completely faulty logic that it's using. Saying that certainty was certain before, but it's not certain now. If 100% certainty covers all bases, not covering just, well, you're welcome now, but in a 1,000 years you won't be welcome. No. It's certain of its welcome. It is certain of its welcome. It's not a conditional. It's not saying I'm welcoming you here because of how I feel now or how you feel or some alignment or something. It's saying, no, you are welcome, period. And if you want to go wander off again into the forest of belief, you can, but you're always welcome here. That's what I experienced. I'm always will be welcome here. And I was certain of that, that I will always be welcome. Certainty will always welcome me. So how could it be possible that it doesn't welcome me now? Only belief would say that. Belief would say, well, you can't be certain of that fact. And I say, yes, I can. Yes, I can be certain of that. It would go against all logic, all reason to say, I cannot be certain of that. If certainty itself says you'll always be welcome, and you're welcome by certainty, and no conditions, you'll always be welcome, and it's certain about that, how could now it be uncertain? Unless it was attacked, unless it somehow, something, you know, forced it to be changed or something like that, which is what belief is really saying. Belief believes that nothing is certain. That certainty is impossible. And it believes that if you're ever welcomed by certainty, it was a fluke, had to do with some anomaly, had to do with some kind of astrological alignment, some kind of space-time flukish type of thing that only happens once, you know, rarely. And so the alignments at this time are not auspicious for you to be welcomed by certainty. Total lie. Again, the alignment for to be welcomed by certainty is always perfect, which is why the previous, as the universal spiritual exercise talks about how you can remind yourself that the alignment right this instant is absolutely perfect. Each instant is absolutely perfect alignment with to be welcomed by certainty. And of course, belief's whole thing is to say that any sort of welcome you get is a byproduct of the cosmos. Moving, the constant movement of the whole universe is in constant spin mode. Moving, spinning, changing. And belief says that occasionally, in some rare, you know, alignment, might make it seem like you're welcome to certainty, but then the alignments change and then you're no longer welcome. So we're just waiting in time and space and situations in time and space for alignments to take place, believing that that's our salvation, waiting for alignments. The fact is we're already perfectly aligned with perfectly aligned with certainty. For the welcome that certainty gives us, unconditional welcome. You're always welcome, meaning it must be you're always aligned, right? If certainty always welcomes us, we're always welcome, because what we are really is certainty. If we're always welcome, how could we not be welcome right now? How could alignments have anything to do with that? It has nothing to do with it. We're always welcome. So what part of space and time transcends always? What part of space and time and situations in space and time changes always? We're just waiting for a change that never comes. It will never come. Those are the facts, and these are the facts that will enable us to transcend the situations in time and space. And the situations that arise in time and space. The pot is constantly being stirred, and it's being stirred right now, and the heat is being, you know, turned up, and all sorts of situations will arise. Innumerable situations will arise. And the key to all of those is to say, I don't need to wait for any alignment in time and space, or any situation to arise in time and space, which is, you know, alignment, to be unconditionally welcomed by certainty. Don't have to wait for anything. I am in perfect alignment right now. Every single moment of the day, we are all in perfect alignment with the welcome of certainty. The always welcome of certainty. In my experience, I didn't feel the slightest bit of being pushed away by certainty, saying, you need to go now or something. You're not welcome anymore. Not the slightest bit. No. It was me that was like, just kind of thinking, I better start working on how I get back here. You know, how do I get aligned with this again? Because I know it can't last. So I better start working about how do I get back here? That's the mistake. Of course it lasts. How could it not? It's unconditional, always welcome. How could that not last? And it's certainty that's guaranteeing it. How could it not last? In other words, certainty is certain that we are children of certainty, children of reality, children of the prime creator. Certainty knows that perfectly. And so we're always welcome. We're always, we'll always be welcome home. The welcome mat is always out for us, always. So why do we need to go into time and space and work on alignments? For what? What are we waiting for? For what? It's a complete waste of time. That is the central teaching. We're simply wasting our time. We're just waiting when we don't have to wait at all. That's really the spiritual path, is just to realize we don't have to wait. There's absolutely no reason for us to keep waiting. There's absolutely no alignment we need to wait for. Never has been, never will be. We're already, we've always been, from the very beginning, we are children of certainty, we are children of eternity. We're children of invulnerability, children of perfect inclusiveness, we're children of reality. We were created that way, and we remain that way, and always will be that way. And reality knows us that we're perfect, and we're perfectly accepted and welcome in reality, perfectly included in reality. And that's a certainty. It's a certitude. Right now. It's a certitude right now. And it's a certitude the next moment, and the next moment, and the next moment, and the next moment, and the next moment. And that certitude never ends. So what are we waiting for? What are we waiting for? What are we waiting for? Belief believes that that this welcome is just, again, a fluke anomaly type of thing that can possibly happen, again, temporarily at best, during rare alignments at best. And in the meantime, it presses its agenda forward with us. Totally delusional. Belief is 100% completely delusional. Has no idea about reality, about what reality is. Has no reference point whatsoever about reality. It is completely blind to reality. So how can it give proper guidance and judgment upon reality? It cannot. And yet it is, it believes it can. It believes it can. It doesn't believe in certitude, it deals in belief. So it believes that it can. It's not certain it can, it believes that it can. It's a difference. It's a big difference. So we have the opportunity to be welcomed out of that dark forest where we're so intimidated by this dark forest that we're, you know, wandering in and living in some decaying, rundown shack in the most abject conditions imaginable. Grateful for grubs, you know, eating dirt, shivering with fear, you know, terrified about our future, insecure, without stability, without any certainty at all, only belief. Only belief. And we're trying to live off this belief. It's like trying to live off sawdust, you know, sawdust in the shape of a loaf of bread. And we, you know, bite into it and it just grumbles, it's just sawdust. All this world is like sawdust. It's like belief making all these forms and everything out of dust. It's just dust. Just dust. And we're trying to eat dust is really what we're doing. We're trying to live on dust. Dust to dust. Has nothing to do with what our true identity, nothing to do with it, nothing to do with our true home, nothing to do with our true experiencing. It's just a fantasy of belief. But you have the opportunity now to see through it, to lay it bare and just see through it and say, aha, gotcha belief. You are a complete liar and deceiver, and we can see it absolutely clearly now. That is a great opportunity. And we need to see it now, because of not seeing that means we'll trust in belief, and belief is going to lead people through a horror house, all the while believing this is for everyone's own good. That's going to create some sort of alignment, you know, that we're looking for. That belief knows we want that. We want to be welcome into the arms of certitude and certainty. So it tries to limit that as much as possible and says, it's working on it. You got to get the right alignments. You got to get everybody holding hands, you know. We got to bring peace to earth. We got to have justice, social justice. We have to have all this equality. We have to have all this stuff. Then we got to wait for the cosmos to align. Then we got to bring that peace everywhere else in the cosmos. We have to do all this stuff, you know. And before we can possibly be welcome, experience any sort of certitude, that's what belief keeps telling us. So, you know, basically you're on an endless trek, you know, endless trek lost in space. Pretty scary, very lonely, very cold, very merciless. But belief really believes is that our attraction to certainty is insanity, and it'll annihilate us. And so it's just trying to stall until it can find a way to get us to somehow give up that attraction forever. So it tells us, you know, we need to wait for alignments, you know, and the alignments are not quite enough. We need to wait some more, and life after life after life after life. See, belief doesn't tell you about all the life after life, all these cycles. Doesn't like talking about that, because if you knew about that, you'd say, whoa, wait a minute, I've already been around the block many times, and I remember, you know, it's still the same. It's the same old song and dance. I'm just being told the same old song and dance I've always been told, and it's never amounted to anything. And then belief tells you, well, the afterlife will be, you'll find what you want. No, because belief is, again, the afterlife is just part of the belief system. It's just the same thing. It's just part of belief. It's belief also. Okay. True life doesn't have cycles. It doesn't live and die. It doesn't have an afterlife. How could life have an afterlife? That's ludicrous. Only death could have an afterlife, right? And death is part of belief, and the afterlife of death is also part of belief. And what belief doesn't tell you is you go cycle through again and again and again and again and again. You identify with flesh. If you knew that, you know, you would say, no thank you, no thank you. Don't want that anymore. And you'd start to properly vet belief. You know, nobody in this world, almost no one, is vetting belief itself. That's what has to be done. That is what the real spiritual path does, is it takes a look at belief and what it's trying to sell us. And says, hey, wait a minute. To be fair, let us get a very clear picture of what it is we're being offered and what it is we're buying into. And if belief is never vetted here, it's a free ride. Whereas belief is constantly lying and deceiving about reality and truth, and insists that we don't even look at that either, you know. So we have every right, and we deserve to be able to look at belief and find out what is it that it's offering us. And it tells us, oh, you know, afterlife and then another life, and we'll be, you know, eternal life. Belief's notion of eternal life is just endless births and deaths. It calls that eternal life. What a joke. That's more like death over and over and over and over and over. Death. That's what it really has to offer, just death. And it doesn't last forever, because we opt out of that. We say, hey, no mas. Let's opt out of that. Let's choose a new idea. But as long as we keep desiring belief to lie to us, we will keep going through the death after life, you know, just over and over and over and over. And belief will keep, you know, we'll keep buying into its lies, keep buying into that. We don't have to buy into it. We deserve better. We deserve to dwell in reality. There's no such thing as death, no such thing as cycles like that. No such thing as alignments. There's no alignments in reality. Everything is perfectly included in the, from the very beginning. Everything is perfect freedom. What need is alignments? No such thing as any alignments. Everything is already perfectly aligned. So we have this great, 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 great opportunity here. And super, super big boost will arrive at some point. The worse the situation gets, the better the help gets. The 20th century really was, there's more war during the 20th century than any time in history. It was absolutely, extremely difficult century for the people who went through it. You know, and there was some extraordinary help during that time. Extraordinary. And yet right now, we're in a situation that is actually much worse. Much, much, much worse. So imagine we must be getting some tremendous help coming in. And to avail yourself of that help, you simply lean towards certainty and saying, I want to properly vet belief. I want to really look at it and say, hey, wait a minute, what is belief really selling me? And just that willingness, just that leaning towards that willingness. You know, and thinking, you know what, I know that I'll be welcome, certitude will welcome me. I just know it. There's a knowing within that I'm welcome to certitude, to certainty. Certainty has this wonderful, unconditional, open door, always welcome attitude towards me. There's that feeling, that knowing, that's all that it takes. And then you're not scared. You say, okay, I'm going to look at belief. Because, of course, the more you look at belief, the more you don't want it. And so it's very important that you realize that certainty does welcome you, because that's your only other option. You either have certainty or you have uncertainty. There is no other option. Right? How can there be a third option? What would the third option be? You either have certainty or you have uncertainty. That's it. So you're going to either lean one way or the other. And the more you look at uncertainty and say, I don't want it, the more important it is that you realize that you are welcome by certainty. Otherwise, you'll feel like maybe you'll be without a home. You'll be nowhere and no home and complete and annihilated or ostracized or something. Nowhere to go, you know. But it's not true. There's either uncertainty or certainty. And if you know you're welcome by certainty, then you can properly vet belief and find out what it's really about, which is what I can testify to that directly. I had an experience of being unconditionally welcomed by certainty and made, I was felt that I was always welcome, will always be welcome. And at that point, I started vetting belief and said, let me look at this. I want to look at this. What's going on? What am I being sold here? It's taken a long time to vet it, yeah, because belief is defends itself ferociously and viciously and cleverly, but by just persevering, continuing on and on and on, it's got clearer and clearer and clearer and clearer and clearer. And it was possible because of having that experience of being welcome. Now, the more that there are ambassadors of certainty in this world, the more people get their courage up to properly vet belief and look at it, because they realize, I can feel that certitude welcomes me. I'm the child of certitude. And then they really start saying, let me inquire into belief and what's really going on. But if you don't have any, you know, don't have any feeling that you're welcomed by certainty, how can you possibly have the leverage to really look at belief? What will happen is belief will just run you around in circles. You think you're vetting it, but you're not. You're not really getting to it. And you'll be waiting for alignments to happen. Which brings us to, you know, the time now. A lot of people are expecting December 21st, 2012, to be this, you know, super cosmic alignment. It's going to cause, going to bring about an ascension, and everything is going to, you know, it's going to be some incredible enlightenment, and we'll all be enlightened, and et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. It's interesting that when you do believe in alignment and it comes up, you may very well trust that now is the time to be accepted by certainty, and you may just choose to be accepted by it. The only problem is it likely to not last, because belief will just say, okay, but you know, if you're smart, if you're really smart, you'll immediately return to existence to find out how you can make this permanent. And then you'll drop it and say, oh yeah, this is really wonderful, this is what I really want to feel, but I can't possibly be permanent yet, so I better find out how to, you know, how to make it permanent, and then you'll drop it. So times of alignment can be powerful, because the expectations that people have, people may very well get a boost at that time, just because their expectations are so tremendous in that direction. But the likelihood that it lasts is, you know, very slim, because it's not grounded in proper vetting of belief at all. In belief, they'll still listen to belief, and belief will say, okay, you know, that's great, you got a glimpse of the goal, now we need to work on making it permanent. And people will just say, okay, yeah, I'm real motivated now to make it permanent, so let me get back and start listening to belief again. How can we make this permanent? How can we get everything aligned so it just stays aligned, you know? And there's the problem. So belief will tell you to flee from certainty by telling you you're super smart if you do. Where the ones who don't, belief will say, well, they're just delaying the inevitable effort to get some kind of permanent alignment. And they may be enjoying themselves now by staying with certainty, but actually the ones who leave are the smartest ones, because they're working on making it permanent. And so they're a lot wiser. Total lie. Very clever lie. So if you are concerned about that, here is the issue that you need to look at. It is that very clever lie. So you don't want to be thought as stupid, and you want to, you know, you think, wow, I really want this to be permanent. And then belief says, if you really want to be permanent, you need to prove that by dropping it so you can work on making it permanent. But if you keep it, somehow you're lagging behind, and you're just delaying and wasting time. And so obviously that's a tricky one, isn't it? Trips us up, because the welcome always is permanent. It's already permanent, it's certain, but a certain is permanent, always. We're always welcome, so it's already permanent. We just need to accept that it is permanent. But remember, belief does not believe in permanency. It does not believe in certitude. So belief has no choice but to say, ah, your experience of that is not permanent. We need to work on making it permanent. You know, but that's the little bone it tosses you. But it doesn't believe in permanency. It cannot. But then it just gets you work, wait. It's already permanent. So the notion that somehow by leaving it, we can help establish its permanency is insane. It's already permanent. By leaving it, we're only delaying, and belief has tricked us once again. We've fallen for the same old trick again and again and again. Belief is fleeing from certainty, and yet it defines it as if it's making an all-out effort to establish permanency in certainty, make your welcome permanent. It tells you that's why it's fleeing away. It's not really fleeing away. It's advancing towards the goal of permanency. That's what it tells you. So you see it and you say, holy cow, I need to run this direction too. See, it is very, very tricky, but simple. It's a simple trick, but it's a trick that grips us, because we so desire for this, to abide in this permanent see of certainty. We want that so much. It feels so perfect, and it is perfect. The idea of losing that is so rightful for us. We say, no, you know, then we feel like it's like the right thing to do must be to establish a permanency. And since we're so used to belief being our guide, And we will believe that its belief is the one that can guide us to that permanency, and then we'll drop it. And then it feels impermanent to us. As soon as we drop it, we say, ah, it wasn't permanent. See? And I need to work. I need to work on the spiritual path to make it permanent. And then we start following the guidance of belief. And tricked again. So I'm speaking from experience here. This is just isn't theoretical. It is direct experience. And this has been something that has bothered me, you know, my entire life. How come I can't get it to be permanent? It's this trick. It is this trick. And belief will run this trick on everyone. Everyone, all of us. Belief will pull this trick. So this is a universal teaching here that I'm giving up. It's a universal teaching. It's not based on this guru or this savior, or this saint or this sage or avatar or ambassador of certainty or anything. It is based on absolute facts of the situation that is the same for everyone. Belief will try to convince you to drop certainty and flee away from it, and it will tell you that it's actually this is trying to help you make it permanent. It's a fundamental trick of belief, and it's the only card belief has to play. When you get right down to it, when you experience certainty and you feel, oh my gosh, I'm perfectly welcome here. I've always been welcome. I always will be. Belief feels completely threatened by that and has no choice but to play that card and say, hey, this is really, you really feel great, don't you? That's wonderful. Now, what you need to do is you need to use that as motivation to make this permanent. Okay, because you know what you're feeling right now can't possibly be permanent because everything's going to change. But belief says, but I know a way to make it permanent. If you just follow me, my guidance, I will make it permanent for you. I promise. And boom, just like that, you drop it and say, okay. It runs that, it plays that card on anyone, everyone. Everyone will reach that point and have that card played on them. And so the answer you're searching for is right here. It's very simple. Is to see through that trick, to really see through it. You have no choice. You have to see through it. Otherwise, you will continue to follow the guidance of belief. And the guidance of belief is nothing but delay because you're already 100% welcome and always will be. So how is that impermanent? How can impermanency be derived from that at all? If you're always welcome, forever and ever, perfectly welcome, always, and there's perfect certitude of that, where is the impermanency of that? Find it. Belief says it's impermanent. State of belief, find the impermanency there. Where is the impermanency? How can impermanency be derived from that? And again, you've caught belief in an absolute, you know, bold-faced lie. And you have to do this. You have to catch belief in this bold-faced lie to really, you know, to see it, to tip the balance here. To tip the balance and say, oh my gosh, all that belief has is lies. That's all that it has. It has nothing but lies. Born liar. If you catch it in these, you know, fundamental lies like this, then that is going to tip the balance, you know. It tips it towards accepting certainty and not being tricked to set it down again. And really, belief thinks that certainty is trying to trick us into remaining with it. It's some kind of deceiver and tricker, etc. That's just belief projecting its own chicanery onto certitude. That it believes that when certainty tells us we'll always be welcome, that's a lie, because belief believes nothing is permanent. So when certitude says you're always welcome, always will be, belief says, ah, I caught certitude in a bold-faced lie, because nothing is permanent. Okay, one is telling the truth and the other is lying, right? Can't be both. Cannot be both. So we can, you know, determine who's telling the truth, who's telling the lie. That's all very important, because its belief projects all its lies onto certainty. And from the logic of belief, of course, logic of belief is that nothing is permanent. It was born of the desire of spirit that reality not be permanent. So belief serves this desire, and therefore it believes that nothing is permanent. Reality is not permanent. So when it hears certain to say this welcome is permanent, it insists that this is a lie, that we're being lied to, and it's doing us a favor by telling us to get away from this liar until we can, till the belief will fix it and make it permanent, you know, but which is a lie. So you have this very tricky situation where belief projects its own lies onto certitude and reality, because it was born of the desire for impermanence. But it wasn't reality that had that desire for impermanence. It was spirit choosing the idea of wanting to be prime creator, which means that reality has to be changed, right? So it means that reality has to be impermanent. So that desire to be prime creator is the desire for impermanence. And the desire for impermanence gives rise to the belief that it is impermanent, which means it believes that when certitude says that, no, that we're all welcome, it believes that's a lie. It insists, belief insists that's a lie, and that it's protecting us from this terrible liar of certitude. And that somehow it will give us the permanency we're craving, but without that terrible liar of certitude, you know, without reality, which is essentially saying it'll make us prime creator, right? A new reality where we feel perfectly welcome because we created it. All right? So you see this, it loosens it up, takes the fear out of it, and it's still tricky, okay, because belief projects all its lies onto certitude and said it's the one that's lying. And yet it makes it a lot easier to keep looking at the situation and saying, oh, you know, wait a minute, okay, just keep seeing the bare bones of it. See the bare bones of the situation. Then it gets a lot easier to see more and more and more and say, and evaluate it properly. Because if you take the position that I espouse here, is to that it was spirit that chose the idea, had the desire to be prime creator. If you take that as the beginning, then everything else that arises, everything, it all fits perfectly. Whereas if you don't take that, nothing fits. All you have is like confusion. You don't know who's telling the truth. You cannot. You're just caught between this terrible, you know, this side says the other side's a liar, this says the other side's a liar, and there's no way to really determine what the truth is. But if you take it, that spirit desire had the desire to be prime creator, chose the idea of wanting to be prime creator on a whim, just kind of, you know, let's just see what happens. Then everything else, you know, fits perfectly well and points out that it's belief that is a liar and its reality is telling the truth. It resolves the entire thing. Because you can see how a belief has to lie. It's a born liar. If something's a born liar, it cannot be true. It can never be true. You see, if you see beliefs a born liar, then you know that certainty is the one that is telling the truth. But if you don't see it that way, how can it be determined who's telling the truth, what side is telling the truth? It cannot be determined. So that is why my whole life I've always emphasized the origin, the root, is all important. Is to see how existence arose, the origin of it, will then make it very clear that belief is a born liar. Has to be. Has to support the purpose that spirit gave to it, is change reality. So spirit cannot believe that reality is unchangeable. It has to believe it's changeable, which, so in other words, it's as a servant, it is serving this purpose, has no choice. So it is not determining objectively at all. There's no objectivity in belief whatsoever. None. It is simply believing that reality must be changeable in order to serve the purpose it was given. It has no choice in this whatsoever. So it's not reliable. It is absolutely not reliable. Whereas we have objectivity, we have reason, we're able to look at it and determine, you know, objectively saying, you know, what side's telling the truth. If one side is a born liar with zero objectivity and has no choice but to serve a purpose of desiring that reality be changed, how can that side be telling the truth? It is merely expressing its wish, you know, its purpose. It's merely stating its purpose, that it wants to change reality. But saying that it wants to change reality, that doesn't establish that reality is changeable. Does not establish that at all. And it has zero facts to back up that reality is changeable. No facts. Everything in existence is manufactured evidence. Totally manufactured evidence. You can see it too. So it doesn't tell us anything objective. What would be objective is to experience reality. Okay, and then report back on what you experience and to in the experience, and I've already done that. So I can tell you that there was not the tiniest shred of evidence that reality is changeable. Not the tiniest shred. Zero. Okay. So in looking at belief and saying, what side's telling the truth? It's reality's telling the truth. And belief is simply stating its purpose, that it wants to change reality. That's all that it really is doing. It's not saying that reality is changeable. It's saying that it wants to change it. You know, it's believing in it, meaning has a desire to change it. But the fact that it has a desire to change it doesn't make reality changeable. So we have to be like a very wise judge sitting on this case of who's telling the truth, you see. Who's telling the truth? That's all I've done my whole life. Who's telling the truth? Who's telling the truth? Sitting and being the judge, you have to judge this. Again, the desire for something does not make it true. To want it to be a certain way doesn't automatically make it that way. Spirit wants to be prime creator, I mean, wants to change reality. It doesn't mean that it is changeable. Spirit wants to find a way to change it. Doesn't mean that it will succeed. Spirit, you know, it says, no, if we try, if we just work at it long enough, it's bound to succeed. Again, that's just a desire to succeed. It's just saying, well, I can't succeed now, but my desire to succeed is still here, so it has to be in the future at some point. Again, that is simply a want, a desire. Reality doesn't run on desires like that. Reality, God, Prime Creator, created reality as it is. A desire to change it doesn't change it. A whim that it be changed doesn't change it. Zero evidence in reality that there's any, that a whim can change it, that a desire can change it. None. So all we can do is want it to be changed in the future. It's right now, you can experience it, and it's flawless. It's not changed. Anyone can experience reality right now and realize that it hasn't been changed in the slightest bit. It never will be changed or changeable. And if we want a desire, it's changed in the future. We can do it, you know, we just get attached to the future. And that drags us along through the muck, through the dust, through dust eating dust. That's all it does. Just being dragged along by desire. I think the Buddha said desire is the root of all suffering. Very true. Very true. I'm not a Buddhist. I'm not any particular religion at all, really. Truth, religion. Truth is the ultimate religion. But, you know, desire is the root of all suffering is very true. Spot on. We keep being dragged along by desire. It just drags us along, you know, keel hauling us, really. Keel hauling is attaching someone by a rope off the backside of a boat and then just having the boat go, you know, and just they just keep, you know, getting boom, 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 dragged through the water. Horrible torture. Or being keel hauled through existence by desire. just suffering. All the while trying to come up with some super weapon to be able to destroy reality with. That's just a desire. We're desiring to be able to change reality. Doesn't make it true. Truth is not at the mercy of desire. Never has been, never will be. Prime Creator did not create vulnerability for the creation, vulnerability to desire. Prime Creator knew in perfect freedom that we could choose the idea of changing reality because we have perfect freedom. So Prime Creator knew that from the beginning, that the potential to choose to change reality could be desired, but there's no possibility that that can happen. Not the will of God that desire can change reality. So the Prime Creator knows all about us choosing the idea of wanting to be Prime Creator. In other words, desiring to change reality. But it's not changeable through desire at all. It's not changeable in any way. It's established. It is. There is nothing that can change it. And so we don't want to be keel-hauled through existence anymore. We don't want to be dragged along through the waters of existence by desire. And desire gives rise to belief, wanting. And belief believes in the goal. You know, it believes in it. And it tells us, yeah, we'll get there in the future. We'll get there in the future. Get there in the future. Where else could we possibly believe it could be? Because it's not here right now. If we check in with reality, reality's here right now. And it's unassailable. Perfect. So, obviously, desire has to put it in the future, saying, no, well, it's something that's going to arrive in the future through some alignment or something. And the water of existence is about to become very turbulent. You know, being keel-hauled through that, you know, is just going to batter us. Belief is really going to batter us. For those who keep being driven by desire and the desire to change reality and the belief that arises that is possible in the future will keep being pulled along. Don't want to do that. So we want to see the situation as it is. See that belief is this born liar, that the desire to change reality gives rise to all of the belief. And belief is absolutely lying, has to lie, has to say, has to twist things, distort things, work with plausibility, do all these deceptive, tricky stuff to keep us believing in the future, where our happiness is in the future, and not here right now, but in the future. Always. It'll tell us, hey, whatever we get here right now, it's not permanent, because the desire is for impermanency, you see? So there's no way you can have the desire for impermanency and still abide in permanency. You won't believe it's permanent. And therefore, you'll think it's folly to continue on with it too long because you need to find out some way to get what you really desire, which is permanency with us establishing what is permanent. So can't have it both. Can't have it both ways. We have to tip it one way or the other, right? You know, tip it towards giving up that desire for impermanency. And then we can abide in permanency, which is here right now. And we don't have to be dragged through the future because what is here right now is perfect. And if we stay in it right here, right now, in the now moment, which is flawless and perfect, every moment is that way. So we never arrive at the future. We never go into the future. We don't project into the future as an attempt to establish permanency. We don't do it. And so then, you know, we're abiding in unconditional love and certitude, and the world, whatever happens in the world, is like the most inconsequential thing imaginable. Like a faint, totally inconsequential shadow play dream. Doesn't impinge upon our experiencing of peace and unconditional love at all, provided we stay with certitude, stay with it. And again, the whole situation revolves around desire and belief, you know, that tricking us, saying, hey, we need to go pursue it in the future because that's where we're going to find it. I'm going to get tricked and tricked and tricked and tricked again, but we don't want to keep being tricked, which is why we're watching these videos and trying to get a better feel of it. And, you know, it's not like, I mean, literally we're being tricked every moment. It's not like we were tricked once or twice. Every moment we are being tricked and deceived by belief. Every single moment. Moment by moment. Every moment we're giving to the future and saying, I better not stay with this moment right now. I better project into the future. What am I going to do in the future to make this permanent? Every single moment we're doing exactly the same thing. Exactly the same thing every moment. Never changes. Everyone's doing exactly the same thing, which is believing that the permanence here right now isn't really permanent, and we need to pursue permanence in the future. Pursue certitude in the future. Every single one on this planet is doing that moment by moment by moment by moment, every single moment, with the obvious caveat of those who are staying in the moment right now are, of course, not doing that. And we want to be like them. We want to be like them. I always say, I want to be like Anandamayi. There's a little jingle. I want to be like Anandamayi. Why? Because she stayed in certitude every moment of her life. She was in perfect certitude here. That's what I want to be like that. We all want to be like that. Except she knew that it's not in the future. It's here right now. So it was not pursuing in the future. We're pursuing it. As if it's not here right now. We're pursuing it in the future. Whereas those who know it is permanent, certitude is already the case, are not pursuing it in the future. They're not projecting in the future. They continue to abide in it every moment. They don't give any moment to the future that way, as pursuit. They know they don't need to pursue it. It's not running away from them. It's permanent. So, and of course, belief will always say that you'll get it after you die. That's one of its trump cards too. It says, you can't get it now, but you can get it in the future. What do you mean? When you die, what's that? In the future, right? And then there's no one to vet, no one to testify to, you know, whether you got it or not. And of course, people are saying, when you die, you have everything you want, and everything's perfect, etc., etc. Who's saying that that's permanent? Is someone saying that's permanent, or is it just another play of belief? Who do you believe there too? See, it's not permanent because I've been in the afterlife many times, and it was not permanent. And it's not what we really want. It's not certitude at all. It's not the certitude we're looking for. The afterlife is not. Death does not give us the certitude of right now. That is right here, right now, and the welcome. The eternal welcome, or always welcome, does not give us that, and does not clarify for us that it's permanent to the extent that we never project in the future at all. No, it does not. We might have some moments where we come across certitude in the afterlife, just like we have moments here. I've had moments here. So you can have moments in the afterlife too. Belief will pull the same trick on you. Then belief will say, hey, that's great, the afterlife, you really had some certitude there, okay, now let's go work on it and make it permanent now, which means just have another birth, and belief says you'll be able to make it permanent by taking this birth. You get fooled again, absolutely get fooled again. And then again, what does it tell you once you're born, once you have another birth? You need to wait until you die. Once you die in the afterlife, you will have certitude. And it just keeps dragging you through, keel hauling you through cycles of birth and death this way. You get in the afterlife, it tells you the way to make it permanent is to have to take another birth. You take another birth, it tells you the way to make it permanent is wait until you die and you'll get it in the afterlife. Over and over and over and over and over. You just go through these cycles. It's just belief lying, that's all. It's just desire for impermanence driving the whole thing. There's desire for impermanence. That's all that it is. And I'm telling you for sure, you can see it. I'm seeing it very plainly and clearly right now. That's all that it is. It's all it's ever been, all that ever will be. Just a complete aimless wandering, just being tricked and deceived, desire, driving these cycles, driving these endless, ceaseless cycles, you know, and we get so tired of it. And we say, come on, can't we at last succeed? And belief will tell us, oh, of course, you're going to succeed. This life, you'll succeed. You just have to wait for some alignment. You have to wait for some situation. Yeah, you know, what's it waiting for? Death. It's waiting for death, your death. And then you get some glimpse in the afterlife. You think, this is it. And then belief will say, yeah, you almost got it. Just one more birth and you'll get it. And then, you know, just keeps going on and on and on and on like that until finally you say, hey, wait a minute. I think I'm being lied to. You know, something's not adding up here. I think I'm just being, you know, go through these cycles. Every time I get into this world, I'm told I gotta wait till I die. Every time I die, I'm told I have to take a rebirth. It seems like this is just this endless loop here, you know, of deception. And then you start vetting belief. You start looking at it. And then you say, ah, I see what's going on. Absolutely. Everyone will do it. Everyone can do it. But I won't say that it's easy. No, I won't say that. That's for sure. Because belief is very tricky. And yet it's very doable. Also, it is very doable. It just seems like, for some reason, it takes some time, you know. It's hard to determine who's telling the truth, you see. And we don't want to waste time. And belief tells us if we abide in certainty, we'll waste a lot of time. Why? Because we'll lose motivation. Okay, we don't want to waste any more time. But belief, the way that belief presents itself to us, we believe that maybe belief was the one that's going to save us all the time. Because it tells us, don't abide in certainty, because you'll lose all your motivation for making it permanent. Whereas if you just have a glimpse of it, then you'll have lots of motivation to make it permanent. And so we, you know, jump away from it, set it aside, say, oh, I don't want to lose my motivation because that'll waste my time. You see? So it's very tricky that way. It uses what we really want, which is not to waste any time, and presents a plan that seems to help us not waste time if we buy into the premise. And it's the premise that is the problem. Always remember that it is the premise that is the problem. If the more you see the premise, the more time you save, because you'll see through this trick that is belief is using against you. It's the premise that is the problem. If you accept the premise that nothing is permanent, that certitude is not permanent, you will feel that spending time abiding in certitude is wasting time and losing motivation to work on making it permanent. You see? Guaranteed, that is your logic, is inescapable logic. So the reason why the path seems to take a long time is there is this inescapable logic coming from a premise. And to the extent that you accept that premise as true, you will be dragged along by this inescapable logic. And you will believe that abiding in certitude, as much as how great as it feels, is actually delaying your getting what you really want. Inescapable, you'll say, the logic's inescapable. However, inescapable logic from a false premise is escapable by seeing that the premise is false. Absolutely escapable. Then you say, you know, it's the premise that is wrong. Not the logic. The logic is logical, inescapably logical, if it takes the premise to be true. But if the premise is false, then all the logic is simply nothing. I don't need to agree with that logic at all. I'm not saying it's illogical. I'm saying it's based on a false premise. So we're not attacking logic. We're pointing out that the premise that the logic arises from is false. So no one's being asked to be illogical or unreasonable or anything like that. Just the opposite. We're asking to be logical and reasonable, but to get the premise right. When you get the premise right, then the logic from the right premise is also inescapable, which is that certainty is eternal. It cannot be changed. Certitude. And the premise that comes from that is that anything that says it's impermanent is simply a desire to change it, and it's not true at all. And therefore, we're not wasting time by abiding in permanence, because permanence is permanent. And we don't need to establish it. It already is. So why would we spend any time in the projecting in the future trying to make it permanent? It's just nothing but total folly. See, that's an inescapable logic from a true premise. We call that reason. What comes from a true premise we call reason. But it is logic. It is logic. We differentiate it from the logic that comes from a false premise. We differentiate it from the logic that comes from a true premise as one being logic and the other being reason. But they're both logic. They're both logic. They're both, you know, if A is A, and B is B, etc., then C must be this. You know, it's inescapable. If you accept a false premise as being true, then you will be bound by that inescapable logic that arises from that. And the only remedy is to choose a true premise, a premise that is true. And that premise that is true is that reality is unchangeable. Certitude cannot be uncertain. That's a true premise. And then that is inescapable logic is that the logic from a false premise is simply untrue. Untrue. And the conclusions that arrive from a false premise are untrue. They're not true. They're nothing but deceit and misdirection, etc. So, this satsang, this inquiry, is what I would expect from the times that we're in right now. I would expect it to be getting up to this level. Now, getting up to this, you know, root of the situation is what I expect. So it is following my expectations. It is. And I do expect the best is yet to come. It should be expected, because the worst in the world is also yet to come. We don't need to focus on that. We need to focus on the best. The worst that is yet to come, well, because the logic is inescapable. Okay, the premise is a false premise. The logic is inescapable, and people are caught in this inescapable logic, and they will follow it, and it's an absolute given that there's going to be severe troubles from that. Inescapable. It's only if we ditch the false premise for a true premise that it's escapable. Okay, it's the only way. Because again, the logic of a false premise is inescapable, and people will have no choice. If they buy the false premise, they have no choice but to follow along with that false logic and the conclusions and guidance and all the stuff that it gives you. And what it'll give you is being keel-hauled through the future very badly. Very sobering situation. You definitely don't want that. So inquiry is super important. The capacity to look at the premise is super important, and I'm able to do that right here, right now. Talk about where desire come from. You know, the whole thing's being driven by desire. What is desiring? It's spirit that's desiring, not the prime creator. Desire did not arise out of nowhere, out of nothing. That is totally false. That's just belief saying that, you see, because belief is terrified that spirit will find out it's the one that chose this desire and can choose again, choose a different idea, and that's it. Whereas if belief says it rose out of nothing, who's to choose a new idea? Who's to choose differently? No, nothing there to choose it, right? So it's absurd. It's absolutely absurd. Belief, desire came from spirit. Wanted to be prime creator, so it couldn't experience it, so it had a desire to experience it. A desire to experience it. Desire doesn't arise from reality, because everything is instantaneous. There's no intermediary step of desire. It's spontaneous. Instantaneous, direct, spontaneous. No such thing as desire. It's because spirit wanted to be prime creator, and it could not change reality, that the desire arose to change reality. And the desire drives belief. The desire to drives belief, and belief believes it's changeable in the future. Okay, that's where desire came from. It came from spirit choosing an idea, of wanting to be prime creator. The remedy is for spirit to choose a new idea. That's the only remedy there is. And we can get to that by accepting a true premise, which is certainty is certain. Truth is true. And perfect certainty can never be uncertain. Okay, that's a true premise. By choosing that, we're able to escape the inescapable logic of a false premise. And that moves us then towards choosing a new idea, which is perfect escape. Perfect, flawless escape. With no possibility of some way falling back into it to desire again. Unless we decided to choose that idea again, which we most certainly will not. Because we will be perfectly certain that this idea cannot be experienced. We will know it. Okay, freed from belief entirely. But the step right now, again, is to choose a true premise that certainty is certain. We're always welcome. We'll always be welcome. The welcome that certainty gives us is unconditional and eternal. Right now. Right now. It's right. It's permanent right now. That's the premise. We can choose that premise. It's permanent right now. And if something is permanent right now, how could it be impermanent in the future? If something is permanent right now, how could it be impermanent in the future? What moment is it impermanent if it's permanent right now? We have to invent time and say there's something called time where it's not permanent. But if it's permanent right now, just consider that. It's permanent right now. If it's permanent, that means it's always going to be that way that it is. So how could it possibly be impermanent? Only by inventing something called the future. That's it. Future time is just an invention. It's just a belief. There isn't any such thing. If something is permanent right now, how could it possibly be impermanent? It's a contradiction in terms. If it's permanent, it's permanent. There isn't any impermanence to it. So all we can do is believe there's an impermanence to it in the future, because right now we could experience, we would know it's permanent. If it's permanent right now, it means there's a knowing of it. It's a fact, and facts are known. So we simply have to invent something called time. We just made it up and say that, well, it is not permanent in time. There's no such thing as time. It's, as far as permanence goes, right? How could there be such a thing as time? What relevance would the concept of time have for permanence? Zero relevance, right? How can time have any relevance to permanence? What does it need a future for? What does it need a past for? If it's permanent, that which is permanent, how could it have a past? How could it have a future? Perfectly permanent. It's easier to see that it couldn't possibly have a future. It might be more difficult to see that, well, you know, it doesn't have a past either. Because someone could always say, well, it was made permanent through some process. But at the very least, you can say it can't possibly have a future, okay? So let's stick with that. Can't possibly have a future. That which is permanent cannot possibly have a future that has any relevance. The idea of a future has no relevance. The idea of time has no relevance. And the idea of how is it made permanent also has no relevance. Okay, so let's take care of the past that way. If something is now permanent, right now it's permanent, how it was made permanent have any relevance to its permanence? We've seen that the future can't have any relevance. Not ridiculous. No relevance. It's permanent right now. no relevance to the future or the past. Again, how if we say, well, it was made permanent some way, how could that really have any relevance at all? It's permanent right now, meaning it's unchangeable. It'll never change. So what relevance does the past have to it? The truth is that permanence, the past, is simply that the Prime Creator created reality as permanent from the very beginning. So there was never a past. There was never a point where it was not permanent. But even if we assert there was, what possible relevance could that have for the fact that it's permanent right now? We can't undo the permanence, right? So what purpose, what relevance does process have? Zero process. We can't fragment it. So if we think we glued it together through fragments, that's the fact that it's permanent now makes that completely irrelevant, totally irrelevant. Because it can never be fragmented. If it's permanent, it can never be fragmented. It can never be changed in any way. There's no process that can change it. So what relevance does process have at all? None. Zero. So process and time have zero relevance to permanency. So you can really, you know, hone in on it like this. And you see, belief is getting less slippery, because you've taken care of time, both the future and the past. Permanency takes care of both those, both irrelevant, totally irrelevant. And belief can still be somewhat slippery. You know, it doesn't give up. It doesn't give up trying. It can't. It cannot give up. It's a servant. As long as the purpose, desire is there, it will serve the purpose of desire. Hey, there's the cat. I need to get that cat. He has to go to the groomer and get shaved tomorrow. I have to get that cat. So if I don't get him now, he's probably going to stay out all night. And that, to me, is somewhat relevant because I got to get that done. Okay, this has been a really great time here. Okay, that's it for this video. Mokey!